we have two experts today. To my right, Dr. A. K. Sood. He is presently the Executive Director in Diplomat of National Board. He is involved in our program in the designing, in the editing and course writing, and he has been involved in the teleconference sessions for last few years. To the extreme right, Dr. Bibha. She is professor in the Lady Hardin Medical College. She is one of our course writers and also one of the counselors. So she knows what are the problems faced by you students, and we will be discussing today, keeping your practical problems in mind. Now I will request Dr. Bibha to highlight the first project, which is burden of disease assessment, because you can know that what is the burden of disease in your area, and accordingly you can plan your services. Dr. Bibha.
The first type of project is assessment of burden of disease. Basically, that means we want to know how much is the health problem, what is the magnitude of health problem, and the objective will be how to control that particular disease or tackle with that particular problem in the community or in any setting wherever you are working. For this, we can take many problems. We can take problems related to mothers and children. For example, nutritional problems are very common. So, anemia of pregnancy or PM in under 5 children, reproductive tract infections, and vaccine preventable diseases, diarrhea. There are so many problems which can be taken, and it will depend what is of your interest and which type of people come to you more. Or if you are working in a health center, primary health center or a community health center in your area, what you would want to study. If we are doing the project based in the health facility, we can use the hospital records. It can also be supplemented by talking to the clients or the people who are coming, or it can be totally a primary data collection by going into the community. So, first identify the problem, then see who are the people who need to be contacted for that, which are the records which we have to see, which age group has to be studied. Then, depending on the time which one can spend, we have to decide the sample size. It also has to be big enough to give us the required results, and then the methodology will have to be decided, which will depend actually on what kind of study we are doing, what kind of disease we are studying.
So, just doing a sort of analysis can give you very valuable information. For example, you just analyze the cases who are coming to the OPD or the cases who are admitted in their wards, for example, their month-wise distribution. Sometimes you analyze the data and you may find that in certain months the cases are coming more. So, maybe you can have some sort of plans for those period. Or sex-wise distribution, some diseases you will find more common in a particular sex, especially in children, for example. Of course, gynae problem will be on one sex only. Then socio-economic status distribution, what is the strata from which the people, where urban people are suffering, rural people, slum people are coming, region-wise sort of this. And sometime even you can study what is the complication rate, how many diseases are getting complicated, how many cases are dying. So, that sort of analysis can sometime give you very valuable information. Even you study the pattern, type of diseases for which the people or children are coming in the pediatric OPD can give you very valuable information. That is one. So, burden of disease you can base based upon your OPD analysis, but more relevant would be community based survey. If you have facilities available, if you have time available, if you have resources available, you may go for community based survey that you cover a urban population or a rural population and try to find out how much proportion is suffering from a particular disease in which you are interested in. So, that can give you a very useful information. So, when you go for community based survey, there are two ways you can do that. One is the retrospective way, that is you when you visit at the time of visit, if there is any person who is suffering from a disease, or you have a reference period of say 24 hours or 2 weeks depending upon the interest area. So, you can go in a retrospective way that the disease is may not be sometime present at the time of visit, but you have a recall period of 2 weeks or 1 day depending upon the disease you are interested. So, you can collect the information and then you can later on calculate the prevalence rate or proportion and draw some conclusion. The other way is that you go for a prospective study, that you monitor a population and see which proportion develops. That is time consuming and may not be within your purview. But that information, the burden of disease, I do feel is a very important area for most of you. If you want, it is easy. More important is that the information which you sort of collect out of it and later analyze in terms of different factors, for example, month-wise distribution or sex-wise distribution or region-wise or socioeconomic status or pattern of the diseases, can be valuable, especially when you are taking decision at your organizational level. For example, logistics system, type of equipment, type of drugs, type of training of the manpower, even what type of health education messages you should give to the communities. So that could be very important implication, policy implication. So I feel that this could be a very important study, and you may go for this particular area also.
I think this is a very important area. It will be applicable not only for the government doctors, it is equally important even for the private practitioners. They can know that what are the patients they are going to get and what are the medicines they can keep it. These will have linking with the resource management also, in which we will be discussing later on. So I think this is a feasible study which can be done in any setup by any student. The next project proposal is evaluation of an organization delivering MCI services. So any organization you can evaluate, maybe a small setup or maybe a larger setup. So depending upon your location and feasibility, you can plan it. Maybe how to approach for this study, Dr. Sood can highlight.
I think this again is a very important area, because the term evaluation itself sometimes is not having a positive connotation. When we talk about evaluation, we start thinking in a negative way. But I do feel that unless we know our deficiencies, we cannot improve the system or organization we are working in. So personally, I feel that could evaluations proposals can also give you very useful inputs, whereby you can improve the current working wherever you are working. As Dr. Jena said, it could be the evaluation of a clinic in a hospital setting, or immunization clinic, MCH clinic, or antenatal clinic. You can evaluate that. Or if you are working in a community health center, you can evaluate the MCH services rendered through this community health center or primary health center or sub center for that matter. So this again project has, I think, lot of varieties can be, varieties of evaluations can be done. So again, depending upon the time you have, depending upon the objective you want to achieve, and depending upon the resources you have, you can limit the scope of your evaluation. As this is going to be a time-bound activity, so maybe you will like to focus either on one aspect of evaluation, because MCS services as such is a very large gamut of activities. So either you focus on a limited activities, and secondly, other thinking is that you can focus on a one unit of the entire MCH organization which is running that. So first point which you should keep in mind is what type of evaluation you are going to do. Evaluation is basically in terms of to which extent the degree, the term of evaluation is defined as degree to which you are able to achieve the objective. So that means first you have to see which area you want to cover. Say if you want to cover a MCS services or immunization services from a primary health center, first thing you should know is what is the objective of the immunization services or MCS services rendered from that particular unit, because evaluation is always in terms of the objective which the organization has in context of that service. That is important to remember. Then considering the objective, then again you can further narrow down. Do you want to go for quantitative indicators of evaluation or qualitative indicators, or both? So that again depends upon the type of resources and time available. So if you want to think that quantitative evaluation is required, so then you will have different set of indicators. For example, in MCH you can think of quantitative evaluation of a primary health center or a community health center or a MCH clinic would be in terms of percentage of target achievement. So that means targets you will get from the organization, objective or goal, that this was the target which was kept for this particular services by the organization in the beginning of the year, and now we are able to achieve this much. For example, proportion of antenatal coverage in a primary health center area, for example. If your target is 80% antenatal coverage, so then you will, in the evaluation, you will try to assess whether we have achieved 80% coverage or our coverage is 60%. If it is 60%, why it is 60%? So that sort of research question you have to build in your proposal. Then you can think of focusing yourself only to intranatal or postnatal care, or maybe you will be interested in say community awareness or immunization. So like that, my point is that if it is quantitative evaluation, then you will have to define a set of indicators on which you are going to judge, and this proportion degree is basically will be from the objectives which you had kept or the target which you had kept for your organization. The other way of looking at evaluation is in term of qualitative evaluation. In qualitative evaluation, our concern is quality of services which are rendered through that particular unit or organization. in terms of technical sort of standards. For example, if it is antenatal care or intranatal care, so when we say the quality, technical quality, that means you will be using some technical expert to observe some of those activities. Say how the immunization is being done, how the antenatal care is being done in this unit, how the deliveries are being done, how the postnatal care is being given. So that means you will have to develop a sort of checklist, and again you should have to, either you should familiarize yourself with that technical aspect, because observation can only be done by a technical person who is aware of that formal rules and procedure of doing that particular technique. So that is one aspect of qualitative evaluation, that is you observe that particular activity. You, when I say you, that means it is expected that technically you should be aware of the correct steps which should be followed in that procedure, like IUD insertion or tubectomy or MTP, and then you see which proportion of these services are being done as per the checklist in the correct way, and which proportion of services are not being done in the correct way. Then within the procedure also there could be certain steps which are done in the correct way and other steps are not being done. So that will give you a qualitative assessment. The other way could be that you look from the physical infrastructure available, because rendering of services is related to a large extent to logistic support. If you have the proper technical equipment available to you, whether equipment is in working order or not, then if you have some biochemical measurement, so again you will require certain laboratory facilities, or again sometime if you don't have the drugs available, for example, so that can also affect the quality part of it. And third important aspect in quality evaluation is the patient level satisfaction, because ultimately if the patients are satisfied, then we can use that as one of the indicator. In our hospital, so many patients visited, out of that 50% were satisfied or 80% were satisfied. So that sort of qualitative evaluation we can think of in terms of, as I mentioned, technical assessment using observation checklist, or it could be physical infrastructure, for example, cleanliness, sitting place, water facilities, toilet facilities available. Or third important component could be in terms of patient satisfaction level. So there are techniques available, there are way of assessing the patient satisfaction also. So here in this situation, our study area would be a hospital, or it could be a primary health center or a dispensary or a community health center or even a sub center, or study population will be comprised of our health service provider, could be medical officer, staff nurse or health worker, or it could be patients when you are focusing on patient satisfaction. Or sometime you may like to know the community awareness, so maybe you will like to do community survey also. The study population in this situation may comprise this. Then again you will have to go for appropriate sampling technique and sampling size, and you have to develop appropriate primary data collection tools and techniques, and then you have to, based upon the indicators you have suggested, you have to analyze the data and do appropriate sort of statistical analysis to draw a conclusion to which extent you have achieved the objective. So in evaluation component, I think most important thing to remember is that you will have to compare the achievement in terms of the objective which were kept for that particular service in the organization.
As Dr. Sood has rightly pointed out, our aim is not to criticize an organization, but our aim is to improve the services of that organization. Whatever objective we have framed for that organization, are we able to achieve that? If not, where is the lacuna? And to take the corrective measures. So those who are having an access to any organization, even you can evaluate your own organization, so that it will help to improve the delivery mechanism of the capacity of that organization. Dr. Bibha, would you like to add something?
Yeah, I think although it gives a negative connotation, but if taken in proper perspective, this can be a very useful information, because when we evaluate, the purpose is to improve the services, and if the students are doing it in their own organization, after taking proper permission, actually I think these two topics which we have discussed are very important. Then we can also have some thing which, like planning and implementation of any of the MCH program activities and schemes, that can be a working project where depending on where you are working, you can improve the MCH services by systematically planning it. For example, if you want to plan an immunization session, which is the community which you are wanting to do, you want to do an immunization camp, try to assess the number of children beneficiaries who were there, what are their immunization status, what are the vaccines which will be required, what are the other manpower will be required. So it can be a useful practical exercise.
Now about the problems that we are facing, like the study material or assignment or there may be some other problem, you can always see it through the IGNU website. The IGNU website you can enquire. If you don't know the website, that is ignu.ac.in, there you go to the student support, and there if you click, you can know when the study material was dispatched and what are the booklets dispatched to you. So all details you can get. If still you have some problem, then you can always contact the regional director, or you can contact the program coordinator, and you will try to solve the problem. The next project is management of resources, that is manpower, materials and supplies and finance in MCH program. So you can also plan about the resources. Dr. Sood, will you like to highlight few points here?
Okay. I think this is another very interesting area, especially in the government setup. The material management or planning for the material management. Material management will include your drugs, your equipment and all other things. So if you are working at in a hospital setting, or whether you are working, I think it at least this project will be more relevant in a hospital setting where you have a relatively a large hospital, so that you can study their store department. So you can study how the demands are estimated for the different departments. Then based on the demands, how they place the supply orders, how they identify the vendors, what is the procedure for that. Then how much quantity they order, for that again you can study. There I think technical things are given in your manual details. Then how the material which is received, how it is handled at the store level, how it is sort of entered in various registers and records. Then what are the materials which should be in the safe custody, like there may be certain items, certain drugs which are very costly. So for that you can think of whether your organization is doing ABC analysis. ABC mean those items which are very costly, they are small in number. So they should be at the disposal of senior level of people who are managing the store. The B items are not that costly, so you can have the mid-level person, and C items, they are very cheap and they are also in large quantity, so you can give the person who is handling those, like staff nurses and so forth. So I think store management is a very important area, especially if you are working in a hospital setting, because in a hospital, this material and the stores, the total cost sometime is about 50 or 40% of the total budget of the hospital is spent on this. Another area you can study is the manpower resource. Nowadays we say that the human resource is the most crucial resource of all other resources, because money, material, equipment you cannot utilize if you don't have proper manpower with you. If the people are not motivated, they are going to waste the other resources. So I think this could be another area that you can focus in your own department or a hospital. What is the human resource, what is the status of human resource development mechanism, for example, could be one area. What is that requirement of a particular category of human resource, what is available, and what are the reason why it is not available. Say if you are working in a hospital setting, you can estimate this human resource development mechanism for doctors, for nurses, for paramedical and so forth. And in each of these, you can focus on their training part, how they are recruited, what are the transfer policies of the hospital, whether they are relevant or not. Then what are the training policies, whether this manpower, once they are induced in the organization, what are the different types of training mechanism opportunities given to them. Then what are the career development opportunities. Then you can also study the work culture, for example. This again you can very interesting area. We usually say that in government setup we don't have the proper work condition or work culture. So people, they may be motivated sometime. If there is a proper work culture. So I personally feel that material management and human resource management is going to provide very useful it will make a good research proposal if you have some you are working in a managerial capacity in that hospital. So you can take a MCH issue and you can then calculate whether material appropriate to that service is appropriate or not, focusing on demand, focusing on the supply mechanism, focusing on the store management mechanism, and all this. And if you are interested in human resource, then you can focus upon recruitment policies, how the human resource is planned in your organization, what are the training policies, what are the transfer mechanism, what are the career development mechanism. Then you can also think of focusing on the work culture in the organization. So I think this in brief could be quite challenging for some of you who are working at a relatively senior position in the organization.
Yeah, although it is important to do it on a regular basis in the larger organization, even in smaller organization, management of resources is crucial, because sometimes I am sure all of us have experienced that child comes for immunization, a particular vaccine is not available or syringes are not available. The reason basically is not that the resources are less, but they are not managed properly. the vaccines are not intended in time, not stored, give waste, things like that. So management of resources can be also done at a smaller level, which so depending on where you are working, you can also take up this as one of the projects.
I think even for a private practitioner, that what are the emergency yes. medicines he has to keep.
Yeah.
So that management, even whatever limited resources he has, how best he can utilize that. So it has an implication for all levels. But as Dr. Sood has pointed out, it has more relevance in a government setup where the manpower and other components yes. are also playing an important role.
The purpose of any services, including the MCS services, is that it reaches the people, and all the beneficiaries who are entitled for those services should get it. This is more true in particularly in terms of in the case of maternal and child health services, because these are largely preventive and promotive services, and each and every mother and child must receive those services. So it is important to find out whether they are receiving or not. So when we want to study the coverage of MCH services, we want to see that what proportion of services are actually being given, provided and utilized by the people. So this can be for all the MCH services we can look up, or in a smaller project we can pick up any aspect of MCH services. For example, we may want to see immunization coverage, we may want to see how much, what proportion of women are getting the antenatal care, what proportion of deliveries are taking place in the institution, what proportion of women are getting prophylaxis against anemia. So we can see the coverage for each one of these or a number of these, and the methodology can vary. If we are looking for a small community, we can take a sample from that community. But if we want to study a larger area, for example, we want to see the immunization coverage in a district, then we will have to do a sampling, we have to use a sampling method which is more feasible also. So one typical example is the 30 cluster sampling which is done for immunization coverage, where the whole population is divided into clusters, and from each a sample is taken.
Dr. Sood, will you like to add something, and you can take up the next one also, that is evaluation of MIS.
Again, coming to the MIS, management information system, is very important. Because this can be used, if you have good management information system, you can do your planning. We had a proposal earlier, so you can, one of the requirement of good planning is that we should have good information. Then you can also, if you have the evaluation the management information system, you can also know what the deficiency of your system or your unit is, and you can overcome those deficiencies. And above all this, whatever we were earlier referring to evaluation, again, to large extent, the secondary data will for evaluation will come from the management information system. So this is an area which I think needs lot of improvement. And here our concern in the government setup management system is that we record so many things, but we don't use that record in really planning and management of the services. And very often we find that someone sitting at the registration desk completes so many registered and record, but hardly that information is used for improving the services in the hospital. So this area I think is very important and can really help the student improving the services where they are working in. So here when you are thinking to take a project on management information system, you can think of in terms of the data formats. What are the different types of forms which are available for collecting the information? If you are working in a hospital, maybe your registration form, maybe OPD form, maybe indoor form, investigation form, all those your case sheets of the patient, you can study that. And you sometimes will find lot of irrelevant information is being collected. So that way you can improve the system by bringing down the number of items in these forms. The second way of looking at the management information system is the type of people who are collecting this information. Are they trained? Sometimes we find they write something which is not readable at all. So why to collect? Why? Because sometimes these people who collect the information, they are either they are not the sometimes technical people. So they don't know what is the importance of that information. Sometimes they don't understand the technical terms, so they will write something and the whole information is then lost. So you can study that is another aspect of management information system. Then third is based on the primary information, how the reports are being generated. Then who is compiling that reports, whether we are drawing some conclusion out of this report or just we are passing that report to the higher authorities. Most often we just sign the report and pass it to the higher authorities without understanding that these reports we have to interpret. Because our action as a manager or a head of the department or a head of the dispensary unit is to sort of from this information we have to draw conclusion regarding our performance, and if our performance is not well, we have to take action. So that is another aspect which you can sort of study. And ultimately now with the computerization in some hospitals, I think MIS is a very important challenge, and this I think we can take, and some of the students can take this as a research proposal. As I mentioned, you focus on the data collection format, or you can focus on the people who are collecting the information, or you can focus on how the data is compiled and how the data is interpreted and used, or you can cover all these aspects in a smaller unit. So this I think is my opinion, that evaluation of MIS we can also take in some areas.
The last one, that is economic analysis, in which you can take up some of the project, like for example immunization. What is the cost of immunization? You can go into details of each cost, like cost of the manpower, that how much money is spent in training a person for delivering the MCH care, what is the salary, then the cost of the vaccine, cost involved in the transporting the vaccine, cost involved in the cold chain itself, cost involved for example in the drugs, syringes used. So all those components you can calculate a cost, and how many children are being immunized, what is the time cost of the time that spent by the manpower, the health worker, all those things can be calculated. And you can find out what is the cost of immunizing one child, for example copper insertion. You can similarly you can find out. So people have a idea that okay, copper T is provided free by government health setup, but how much government actually puts the input, what is the cost of providing one copper T? If you calculate, you find it is not that cheap. So the details of calculating this will go into the economic analysis related to MCH care. Dr. Sood, you will
I think this is a very important area, but maybe some of us who are medical, most of us are medical background, so sometimes we are afraid of doing this economic calculation. But as Dr. Jaina said, it is very important that now our concern is how much money the government is spending, whether the money is worth it or not. And he very rightly said, if we calculate the, although we think that immunization vaccines are almost free, copper T is almost free, but the administrative cost of these is very high. He mentioned about the manpower cost. So if we take into consideration the labor cost and material cost, I think we will be surprised that even immunizing one child in a government setup may cost us 200 rupees or 150 rupees if we calculate. So I think these are the things which in long term and future, I think they are going to be the key issues. The government is also thinking of sort of cutting down our unnecessary expenditure and ensuring that we give value to the money for which the exchequer is paying to us. I think this is another area, but I feel some of our students may be afraid to take that.
In fact, when we are talking of cost, there is also cost to the people. Daily wager may lose a day's wages to get the child immunized. So the costs are on both sides, both the costs can be studied. It is very interesting, but slightly difficult.